Good morning, church. Good morning, good morning. How are you guys doing this morning? Well, hey, I just wanted to, can we just start off by just in a moment of prayer? Lord, we come before you right now, and it's just so evidenced, Lord, by our worship this morning. We have a singular focus, and that singular focus is you. Lifting high your name in worship, Lord, we are here for one thing, and that is to meet with you. And Lord, you have met with us. Your presence is here with us. And so, Lord, as we go into a time of studying and opening your word, would you give wisdom to our hearts and our minds as we study, as we learn? Lord, help our hearts to lean forward into the passage this morning. Lord, be with us now as we listen to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, listen, you may not have seen me last weekend at church. And I don't miss church a lot, but something big happened in our family, and I would love to share that with our church family. We added a new member. And I know that many of you were concerned because we didn't have a name picked out, and but she has one, and her name is Ava Grace, and we are so blessed. So thank you so much for your prayers and your love during this season. Now, this has been a massive blessing to our family. And those of you with kids, you know, this is a pretty unique season in the life of a parent, right? It's a pretty unique season. Leading up to the birth of our baby girl, we already have a son who is 4 years old. And so I thought that I knew and remembered exactly what it was like and how it felt before, right? The long nights, the lack of sleep, the constant watching and caring for our child. And I was like, yeah, we've been through this before. We've got this on lockdown. We are ready. It's going to be no problem. Then we had her. And I couldn't believe how many things I had forgotten. It's only been 4 years, and I had forgotten so many things, or how it actually feels in my body. Maybe it's because I'm older. I don't know. But how it feels in my body to not get a lot of sleep, to be up at night, to be constantly worrying and caring for our child. It's relentless, you know, getting up in the middle of the night, constantly worrying about each and every strange noise that comes out of their mouths. And there's a lot of them, and a lot of them are weird. Now, this is a little bit of an aside. I don't know if you guys are like this, but I'm like this. And sometimes in the middle of the night, I'll hear a strange noise, or I'll hear the lack of a strange noise, which should mean peaceful, but not to me. And so I'll get up out of the bed, and I'll walk over. And we have a bassinet in our room right now, and I'll just get down real level with the bassinet like this, just to make sure that her chest is going up and down. And I'm like, we're good. And I'll get back up and I'll go to sleep. I mean, it's weird, but it makes me feel better. Does anyone else do that? Has anyone else? Okay. Goodness, still, someone said. Still doing it. Okay, good. I didn't know if that was weird. I'm all alone. I know it's like a creepy picture. I'm just like hovering over my baby. It's fine. But it makes me feel better and helps me get back to sleep. But it is relentless work to care for a little baby. But it's wonderful, and it's a blessing, and it grows us in love, and it grows us in parenting. There's a lot of mistakes that happen, and there are a lot of obstacles that need to be overcome, but we keep going, we keep trying, we keep moving forward. We never give up because it's worth it, right? So we are relentless in our care for our children. But we're going to talk about today another area that we need to be relentless in, which we are going to see in the text today, which is to be relentless in our faith. To have relentless faith. That's the title of the message this morning. Relentless faith. And we are going to be in Mark chapter 2. So open up your Bibles, Mark chapter 2. We're going to be in verse 1 through 12. And we're going to take a look at four guys who are taking care of their paralyzed friend. And we're going to get a look, a real in-depth look, of their relentless faith. So it's Mark 2, 1 through 12. And I'm going to start reading for us. Just right in the beginning here. And when he returned to Capernaum, after some days, it was reported that he was home. So Jesus is returning back to Capernaum after his initial preaching tour around the Sea of Galilee. He was traveling around and he was preaching and he was teaching and he was healing and he was coming back to what the end of the verse says here was his home. His home during his Galilean ministry was Capernaum, and that ministry lasted about a year and a half. And so now he was coming back. This is not clear in the text, but this was most likely the home of Peter and Andrew. But this was his home base in Capernaum. Now the news of Jesus teaching and healing were widespread. If you look back just one verse in chapter 1, verse 45, we see that the leper that Jesus heals, instead of listening to Jesus and not telling anybody and going straight to the priest and just telling them, the leper who gets healed doesn't do that. He doesn't listen to Jesus. He goes around and he starts telling everybody that Jesus healed him. He goes around to all of the towns, like on a tour, and starts telling people about what Jesus had done. And it was so intense and so incredible that Jesus no longer could go openly into a city any longer. He would just get rushed by people. And so he kind of chilled out for a little bit. As the text says, after some days, he comes and he returns home. It goes on, the verse says, and many were gathered together so that there was no room, not even the door. And he was preaching the word to them. It got crowded pretty fast. And when people learned that he would return to Capernaum, this verse says that many gathered together. I think that that's a bit of an understatement. This was jammed packed, shoulder to shoulder in this house, all the way to the door, maybe even through the door. Maybe this was even a house that was on the street and maybe people were kind of pouring out of the door. By looking at this house, you could tell from the door that it was absolutely filled, absolutely full, packed to the brim. There was quite a crowd that was there, and Jesus was there, and he was preaching the word to them, he was preaching the gospel to them. It goes on to say, and they came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. This is the first thing that we're going to see in relentless faith. Relentless faith takes action. Relentless faith takes action. And they came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. Now, we don't know the details of this paralytic man. We don't even know his name. We actually don't even learn his name or learn the names of his four friends. But we know, while we don't know their names, we know that they had faith. And while we don't know the details of this paralytic man, we don't know if he was able to move anything. We don't know if he was even able to talk. We don't know how long this had been affecting him. We don't know how it happened, whether it was from birth or brain damage or spinal cord injury. We just know that he was paralyzed in some way. He was someone who was unable to walk. So enter these four men. And I'm going to get some participation here. Can I get four men who are feeling a little bit strong this morning? Can I get, just go ahead and raise your hand. Four men. No one's feeling it. Come on up here. Come on up. Come on. Four able-bodied men. I promise. Come on, yeah. We've got two. We need two more. Two more. We've got three. Can I get one more? We got one more. All right. Perfect. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. Come on over here. There's a bed. And now this is not historically accurate. I just want to be super clear. It's not, but it serves our purposes, I think, really well. And I was going to pick someone who was a little bit heavier that you guys would have to, you know, to make sure you got your morning workout in. But I noticed that my nephew was here this morning. And so, Judah, would you come up? Come on up here, buddy. So this should be pretty easy for you guys, I think. And what's up, dude? You're going to go ahead and sit or lay on that bed. And great job. Wow. Amazing. So enter the four men. They heard the stories, they heard the rumors, they heard the testimonies that this man, Jesus Christ, can heal. Now, up to this point in Scripture, there had been no healing of a paralyzed person, and so they didn't know the specifics, but they had faith that Jesus could heal their friend. Now, you have to be aware of the timeline here as well. It was just reported that Jesus was home, so this situation required some urgency. They just got the report. Jesus is back home. We got to go and see him. The crowd's going to be crazy. They didn't know how long Jesus would be back for. They didn't know if they would make it in time. They didn't know if they would make it before the crowd, so they sprang into action. They heard the news and grabbed their friend and made their way to the house where Jesus was. And so they had their friend lay on a bed. They each took a corner of the bed, and they lifted it up. So if you guys would demonstrate that for us right now. All right, so I'm just going to have you guys stand there. All right, don't drop my nephew, okay? I'm going to have you stand there for just a little bit, all right, to get the full picture of this. This is no easy task. Now imagine if this was a full-sized man, right? It's going to take a little bit of work getting the man to Jesus. This relentless faith takes action. And so what does an active faith look like? Well, I think that we see that by the four men right here. We see an active faith. We see eyes to see needs. They knew that their friend was in need, that he was struggling, that he was sick, that he had no use of his, maybe his body or his legs and could not walk. They saw his need. Their active faith had eyes to see needs. Their active faith also had an attitude of you before me. You before me. Now, remember the timeline here. This required urgency. Jesus had just come back. They had just got the report. They got to grab their friend and go right now. And so that means that they dropped whatever they were doing at whatever time they were doing it. Maybe they're doing something really important. But they said, he is more important than us. I'm counting him more significant than myself. Him before me. I'm dropping what I'm doing, and I'm going after him. The third thing is they were focused on Jesus. They were focused on Jesus. We're going to Jesus. We're taking our friend, and we are making sure that this friend gets to Jesus. Their eyes were focused on Jesus. And fourth, they put in the work. They had to pick him up, and they had to carry him over. They put in the work. So my question to you is, how have you been doing in this area of active faith? Have you had eyes to see needs, or have you been avoiding the need? Have you been having an attitude of you before me, or have you been too busy with your own plans? Have you been focused on Jesus, or have you been losing focus on Jesus? Have you been putting in the work, or have you been putting off the work? Because these men knew, they had faith in Jesus that he could heal, and even though they didn't know the outcome, they knew the one who controls the outcome, and that's enough to act. Even when I don't know the outcome, I know the one who controls it, and that is enough to act. A relentless faith takes action. It takes action. Here's the second thing we're going to see. You guys doing all right?
Yeah.
All right, perfect. A relentless faith overcomes obstacles. And when they could not get near him because of the crowd, this is verse 4, when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. These men are faced with some obstacles. First one, how are we going to get him to Jesus? Okay, let's put him on his bed and then walk him over. Then carrying the man for who knows how long and who knows how far, they get to this house and what are they greeted with? A house full of people, packed to the brim with no way in the front door. It's pretty good. It's pretty discouraging, right? Well, you guys made it to the house. You can let down the bed. Thank you guys so much. Thank you very much. It takes some work. Yeah, round of applause. Perfect. Good job. Thank you guys. Thank you very much. Thank you, Judah. Way to go, buddy. They were faced with some obstacles. A couple of things here. That's got to be pretty discouraging, doesn't it? We just did all of this work. We just carried him all the way here. My arms are sore, and we can't even get in. I've been there before. You've probably been there before. You've worked so hard at something, so hard. Then on the other side of that, you're faced with another obstacle. It makes you want to quit, doesn't it? It makes you want to quit. It's discouraging. But another thing here, it shows the heart attitude between these men, the difference between these men and the crowd. Do you notice? It's really subtle in the text, but do you notice that? There's a difference in the heart attitudes of the men, the four men, and the crowd. These four men have a relentless faith, and they are focused on bringing their friend to Jesus no matter what. And the crowd, well, the crowd won't even simply move aside for a paralytic person to come through. This crowd is very self-seeking, self-serving, self-indulgent, and they didn't move. And it wasn't for lack of trying. The account in the Gospel of Luke tells us that they tried to get through the crowd. The crowd would not part. It would not let them pass. The crowd was all about themselves. They wanted to stand where they were standing, and they didn't move. They had no sympathy for the man who was laying on a bed being carried by four friends. They wouldn't even move aside. Now, I don't think that our church is like this, but I wanted to just give us a warning. Church, we cannot be this crowd. We cannot be the crowd in the scripture. We cannot be the self-serving, self-seeking, self-indulgent people who don't move. We can't just be a crowd like this crowd who come together to listen to the teachings of Jesus and not act. We have to be the four guys in the story. Four guys who will be relentless in our faith to see with eyes that see needs, putting others before ourselves, focusing on bringing people to Jesus, and not being afraid of what it's going to take to get there. We can't be the crowd. We have to be the four. Because relentless faith overcomes obstacles. It overcomes obstacles. And these men overcame getting in there, trying to get through the crowd, discouragement. And then when they couldn't see a way to get through, they had to get creative. I can kind of just imagine this conversation happening, right? The frustration. They're like, man, they won't let us through. Can you believe that? I can't believe that they won't let us through. Why won't they just step aside? We've got a friend who can't move and we just want to bring him to Jesus to get healed. I won't believe it. Can't believe it. They won't even let us bring our friend to Jesus. Then one guy like is sarcastically like, yeah, what do they expect us to do? Bring him through the roof? And then they all like stare at each other and they like take that moment and they're like, let's bring him through the roof. Let's bring him through. And so they got some rope and they attached it to each of the four corners of the bed and they climbed up on the roof of the house. Okay, a couple of things here to give us a good picture of what's going on. First, houses in this region in this time would be one story tall and they would not have interior stairs to the roof. They would have exterior stairs to the roof. And if they didn't have those exterior stairs up to their roof, their neighbors who were very close would certainly have stairs to the roof. That's how they would get onto the roof. And then the roof in those days, they would be flat, and they would be made out of large wood beams going across. And in between those beams would be smaller pieces of wood and sticks. And then in between those wood and sticks, there would be thatch, which would probably contain some sort of grain and some twigs to fill in the holes. And then on top of that thatch, they would place a thick layer of mud. Thick layer of mud. And then on top of that, when that dried, they would put on tiling, some sort of stone tile or clay tile. That's the roof. That's what the roof would have been. And so these men, they had to figure out where Jesus was in the house. They had to do some like geometry or like jump and look through the door over the heads of the people and see. They're like, all right, he's right about there. So we need to dig right about here. They had to figure out where he was. And then, knowing full well that they would have to either pay for the roof to be fixed or to fix the roofs themselves, they started digging through it. Well, it turns out that they got it right. They got right where Jesus was. They started digging. Now, this brings us to another obstacle. This would be pretty distracting work, wouldn't it? Can you imagine? As they're digging through the roof, there would be noise. There would be probably debris falling down, probably on Jesus' head as he's teaching. Can you imagine twigs and debris and thatch and mud and clay kind of falling down onto the... It would be incredibly distracting, wouldn't it? And it would take some time to open a hole big enough for a bed that was probably about this size, maybe 3 feet, 3.5 feet by 4 feet. It would take some time to dig a hole that big into the roof. And so they must have been thinking, like, how's the crowd going to respond, right? Are they gonna like boo us when we get up there? Like, are they gonna hate? Like, what's going on? I don't know what they're gonna think. And then secondly, how is Jesus gonna respond? How is Jesus gonna respond? Because distractions usually aren't super welcomed by teachers, right? If you've ever been in a classroom before, they're not super welcomed, right? Teachers like to be undistracted because it detracts from the teaching, detracts from the message, and so they like the attention of the people. And so would Jesus be angry? Because for sure, if someone's digging through the roof, the crowd is going to lose focus, and they're going to be like, what's happening right now, right? They're going to lose focus. Like if someone was being lowered from the ceiling, Like right now, you would probably look up, right? No, don't worry, no one's gonna be lowered from the ceiling, all right? But if someone was coming down right now, how focused would you be on the message that I'm preaching? You'd be like, okay, is that guy gonna be okay? What's going on? You would be focused on that. So distractions usually aren't that welcome. What if he gets angry? What if he tells us to leave before we can get healing for our friend? Still, they press on through the obstacle because relentless faith overcomes obstacles. What are the obstacles that you need to overcome in your life, in your faith? Maybe it's the obstacle of frustration. This is harder than I thought it was going to be. This is taking more from me than I thought it was going to be. This is frustrating. I don't seem to be getting anywhere. Maybe the obstacle is time. This is taking a lot longer than I thought. I really wanted to be through this a long time ago. I wanted to be done with this a month ago. Why am I still going through this? Maybe the obstacle is time. Maybe the obstacle is fear. It may not happen like I thought it would. The outcome might not be what I thought it was going to be. What if it's something completely different? What if it's not something that is going to be good for me? Fear. Maybe another obstacle is uncertainty. I literally don't even know. I don't even have a thought on this. I don't even know how we're going to get through or how it's going to get better. I can't even see the light at the end of the tunnel. It's so uncertain. There's a lot of obstacles that need to be overcome in our faith. But I wrote this down. When there are obstacles, what can we do? When there are obstacles, what can we do? First thing I wrote is we can dig in. Like the four men dig in through the roof. We can dig in. We can get our hands dirty. When there are obstacles, we can dig in. I'm not going to move backwards. I'm not going to be discouraged. I'm not going to be thwarted. I'm going to keep moving forward. I'm going to be relentless. I'm digging in. I'm planting my feet. I'm going forward. When there are obstacles, dig in. Here's the next thing. When there are obstacles, hold hope. Hold hope. These four men had a hope. They had a singular hope that if they got their friend to Jesus Christ, that he was going to be healed. Their hope was in Jesus and that he would heal their friend. Hold on to hope. Our hope as Christians, we have the greatest hope on the earth and under the earth and above the earth. We have Jesus Christ. We have the hope of Christ. We have the greatest hope. Hold on to that hope when obstacles come your way. Your hope is in Jesus Christ. When there are obstacles, number three, you are not alone. You are not alone. You're not alone. This wasn't just one man going after Jesus. This wasn't just one man bringing his friend to Jesus. This was a group of people. This was a community. This was a small group coming together, caring for their friend, not alone, but grabbing each other, using the gifts that they had, going along with one another. You're not alone. Don't isolate when you face obstacles. You're not alone. Reach out. Reach out to others. When there are obstacles, number four, don't quit. Trust me, it's going to get discouraging. Trust me, it's going to get hard. Trust me, you're not going to always see the immediate path to follow. You might have to get a little creative. But don't quit. Keep pressing on, and that's going to become very apparent why it's important that we don't quit in just a little bit in this message. And then finally, trust God. Trust God. When I get to a place of obstacle, trust the Lord. Lord, you are going to get me through this. I know that you are faithful. We just sang it this morning. He is faithful. He is good. I trust you, God. I trust you to get me through this. Relentless faith overcomes obstacles. And then, finally, this. Relentless faith experiences God's power. Relentless faith experiences God's power. Let's look at verse 5. It says, and when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Here it is. Here it is. When Jesus saw their what? Their faith. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to him, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Jesus didn't give them a rebuke for interrupting his teaching and being a massive distraction. He saw their faith, and he took this moment of distraction, as a moment of ministry. He took it as a moment of ministry, an opportunity for supernatural ministry. I had a pastor who used to use this verse to discourage the children from being distractions in church. And he would say, look at how distracting they were. They opened up the roof. Can you imagine what that must have been like and how distracting they were? And they were distracting the people from Jesus' message. But when Jesus saw their faith, he had compassion on them, and he said to them, even though that they were distracting, and that was a great sin, he said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." And he used that as a... That's not what this passage is saying, okay? Jesus is not in this moment subtly rebuking them for being a distraction. Jesus is offering the thing that only Jesus can offer. He's offering this man forgiveness. He's offering him forgiveness, and he's using this opportunity for supernatural ministry. And he says, "Son," which doesn't necessarily mean that this was a young man, but it's a term for affection, for tenderness. So in tenderness, Jesus says, "Son, your sins are forgiven." We are seeing God's power in action right here. Now, this might have been a little confusing, right? Because why did the four men bring their disabled friend to Jesus? Did they bring him to have his sins forgiven? I don't think so. I think that they wanted him to come and be healed. They brought him there for healing. This might have been a little bit different than what they expected. They came to have their friend physically healed, but Jesus, in his love for us, always meets our deepest need first. He always meets our deepest needs first. And they are not what we sometimes think that they are. They thought it was healing his body, but Jesus knew it was healing his spirit. And we get caught in this as well. Sometimes we think that we need healing in one way, but Jesus knows that we need it at a deeper level. We might think that we need a financial need met. Jesus may know that it's our need to be more dependent on him. We may think we have need a marital problem healed. Jesus may know that what we need is to be more focused on him. The thing this paralyzed man needed more than anything wasn't being able to walk again. It was to be forgiven. It was to be forgiven by Jesus Christ. So I want you to write this down if you're taking notes. This is really important to know in the ministry of Jesus Christ, is that Jesus doesn't only heal the physical. He heals the spiritual. Jesus doesn't only heal the physical, he heals the spiritual. And the adverse of that is also true. Jesus doesn't only heal the spiritual, he heals the physical. Jesus doesn't only heal the spiritual, he heals the physical. And he's going to do just that in just a second here. Now, it goes on in verse 6. "Now, some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, 'Why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?'" I love this. "And immediately, Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, said to them, 'Why do you question these things in your hearts?'" So if you don't know who the scribes are a group of scholars who were very influential authorities, especially as it relates to the law of Moses and like the oral traditions. And these guys challenged Jesus a ton throughout his ministry, mainly on his disobedience to traditional practices like eating unclean things or not washing his hands or the Sabbath or keeping the Sabbath. So I'm guessing that they're here listening to Jesus to catch him in an act of wrongdoing, to see if he slips up in what he says and how he speaks. So when Jesus says, "Son, your sins are forgiven," they're probably like, "Here it is. This is the moment. Here's the blasphemy we were waiting for. We can go and take this and we can report it back. This guy's done for. This guy is trying to say that he's God. Only God can forgive sin. Who is this Jesus to say that he can forgive sin. I love this. And then Jesus just straight up reads these guys' minds. He reads their minds. As they're thinking this, as this thought is going through their mind, who is this man? Why does he speak like that? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? He reads their mind, which is awesome, and answers the very question that they never asked out loud. He answers. He says, why do you question these things in your heart? He proves himself to be exactly who he is. Can you imagine how stunned these men would be? They're thinking that in their minds, and then Jesus says that. They're like, oh my goodness. Okay. And here's what Jesus says. He says, which is easier? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? Which is easier? Now, I want to bring some context to this because this reflects a contemporary traditional theology of the day, which was that there is no sick man healed of his sickness until all of his sins had been forgiven him. That's why paralytics were considered to be cursed in the ancient times. It's because that no sick man can be healed of his sickness until all of his sins had been forgiven. And so they equated sinfulness, and a lot of sinfulness, with disease, with weakness, with being paralyzed. And so Jesus is addressing this right here. He's like, which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? Well, for sure it's easier to say your sins are forgiven, right? This is an inner moral need that doesn't really have any outward physical evidence to show for it, right? He could just say that, but then no one would know if that actually took place because it's happening in the inner man. Forgiveness is. And so it's for sure easier to say that. And so to fulfill this traditional thinking of there is no sick man healed of his sickness until all his sins had been forgiven him, this is what Jesus does. But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. And he rose, and he immediately picked up his bed, and he went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. Jesus heals the man. He's like, which is easier? And then he takes the harder one, and he does it. He heals him to prove that he is God, to prove that he can forgive sin. And the truth is that Jesus Christ is not only capable and able to forgive sin. Look what it says in the text. But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sin. He's not only capable and able to forgive sin, he has the authority to do it. He has the right to actually do so. And he tells the man, rise, pick up your bed and go home. And he did. He got up. He and his four friends experienced the power of God because of their relentless faith. And then they all glorified God together. They were all amazed and glorifying God, saying, we never saw anything like this. I love the quote by Charles Spurgeon on this passage. It says this, I think I see him. He sets one foot down for the glory of God. He plants the other to the same note. He walks to the glory of God. He carries his bed to God's glory. He moves his whole body to the glory of God. He speaks, he shouts, he sings, he leaps to the glory of God. Because of the relentless faith of these four men bringing their friend to Jesus Christ, the power of God was unleashed upon this place. Can you imagine the atmosphere in that room? This man who was paralyzed before, who was lowered down through the roof, was told to rise, pick up your bed, and get up. And he did. Jesus heals the man. That place must have been on fire, right? They blew off the roof that they already dug through, glorifying God, shouting and praising. And the thing that I love about this is that the paralytic grabs his bed. He picks it up. And he takes it home. He goes home. This bed, this thing that he had been laying on forever, for a long time, in sickness and weakness, This bed, which was once a symbol of weakness and sickness after an encounter with Jesus Christ, is now a symbol of testimony and healing. This bed, once a symbol of his weakness, of his sickness, after an encounter with Christ, he picked it up. And now, this bed is a symbol of his healing and of his testimony. And he's taking it home, and he's going to be able to see that every time he walks by it. I had an encounter with Jesus Christ. He healed me. He didn't only heal my legs and my ability to walk, he changed my eternity. The bed he was carried in upon, he is now carrying out, tucked under his arm. What an awesome picture that is, isn't it? Because of the relentless faith of him and his four friends, he experienced the power of God. Can you imagine if maybe even one or two of these men didn't show up? What would happen? This man may never have received this healing from Christ. He may never have received it. He may never have gotten the opportunity to get to Jesus. But because of the faith, the relentless faith of these four men, this man was able to experience truly the power of God. So my question to you today is pretty simple. Are you one of the four friends? Are you one of the four friends? Do you have a faith, a relentless faith that is taking action? Do you have a faith that has eyes to see needs around you? Do you have a faith that is overcoming obstacles? Going towards them, not quitting, not giving up, but going through them, focused singularly on Jesus Christ. Are you one of these four friends? Because let me tell you, there are people all around you who are in need. They are in need, and they need to be brought to Jesus Christ. They need to be brought to him because they need healing. Are you one of the four friends? I would just encourage you, be one of the four friends. Don't be the crowd in the story, sitting there listening but not acting. Be the four friends. Take action in your faith. Be relentless in your faith. See the need. Help those around you. Consider them more than yourself. Are you one of the four friends? And then this, finally, as we close, what is your bed? What is your bed? What is the thing that is the symbol of weakness and sickness in your life? That maybe you need healing from. You need to have an encounter with Jesus Christ. What is that for you? What is that symbol of weakness and sickness that needs to be brought forward to Jesus Christ so that he can turn that weakness and sickness into testimony and healing? What is that? Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. Lord, help us. Our desire is to be like these four friends, is to have a relentless faith, to have a faith that is active, to have a faith that is overcoming obstacles, to have a faith that is truly experiencing the power of God in our lives. Lord, help us. Show your power to be true right now. Lord, I pray for anyone in here who is struggling with a sickness, with a weakness, Lord, whether it be physical, whether it be addiction, whether it be a stronghold of sin. Lord, whatever that is, Lord, would they have an encounter with you right now? Right now. And would they experience the healing and the forgiveness and the testimony of your power right this moment. With the miracle that happened in this scripture of this paralyzed man rising, picking up his bed and going home, would that happen today, right now? Would you heal? Would you meet the physical needs of someone right now? Would you meet the spiritual needs of someone right now? Lord, we know you are faithful to do it. And so our focus is on you, Jesus. Help us. Be with us, Lord, as we continue to worship your name. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.